This is Mr. XYZ who came with complaints of fever for 1 month. Fever one episode 2 months back. He had swelling of both the lower limbs with abdominal distension and exertional dyspnea for past 2 months with fatigue. And he had bilateral leg pain with decreased urine output for past 1.5 months. So on examination, this gentleman had normal vitals, but he had pallor and a right axillary lymph node, which was significant, and bilateral pitting pedal edema. His JVP was elevated. He had distended abdomen due to ascites with no organomegaly, and he had normal vesicular breath sounds bilaterally, normal S1 and S2, and his right ankle jerk was absent. So, investigating, we found that his hemoglobin was low, his iron and TIBC was low. Scopies were done outside as well as here, both were normal. His urea was elevated and creatinine was 10. On urine analysis, it showed a RBC of 1 to 2 and WBC of 9 with 1 plus protein urea. So we sent an inflammatory panel, also showed elevated ESR and CRP and low complements. Rest of the things were all normal. He had a normal ANA, DSDNA, cryoglobulins, BBVS was negative. Bone marrow biopsy was normal and lymph node biopsy was also normal. So what would the diagnosis be was the question. So we came across differentials. His HP was low, so we thought it could be anemia with CCF. It could be acute renal failure because the history was 2 months long only. He could be having CLD with portal hypertension. He could have autoimmune disorders like SLE or other vasculitis, maybe PAN or ANCA associated vasculitis. Then in the ward, patient started complaining of body aches and increased pain in the lower limbs, and he developed a foot drop in the right lower limb. So we did a muscle nerve biopsy, muscle nerve skin biopsy, results of which were normal, and we got a renal biopsy done that showed diffuse necrotizing and crescentic glomerulonephritis. IF sections showed a linear deposition with 2+, 2+, 3+ IgG and with focal mesangial C3 deposits. So the diagnosis we came across was anti-GBM with mono neuritis multiplex. Coming to the approach of how we came to the conclusion, was basically this patient had loss of renal function. When he came, his creatinine was very high, and he had oligourea. He was putting not more than 100 ml of urine per day, and he had features of glomerulonephritis. So in RPGN, morphologically there are extensive crescent formations. So what initially happens is that there will be a cross reaction of the antibodies to the basement membrane of the Bowman's capsule. This will induce rents. Rents are just holes and scattered breakage in the epithelium. And from these pores, all the fibrinogen and plasma products, they leak out into the Bowman space, and then there is fibrin formation and there's influx of T cells and macrophages, and this gives rise to an inflammatory reaction there causing glomerulonephritis. So this is how it happens, the diagram. This is a normal kidney, and on the other side we can see how the Bowman's how the basement membrane has been damaged and crescents are formed. So there are four types of RPGN. Type 1 is anti-GBM antibody disease. Type 2 is because of immune complex deposition. Type 3 is a posse immune glomerulonephritis. It can be ANCA positive or negative. And type 4 is when there are double antibodies positive. So we diagnosed it as being rapidly progressive renal failure. This is because the history was less than 2 months, and on presentation he had a very high creatinine, So renal failure is defined as increased serum creatinine of more than 0.3 mg per deciliter in within 2 days, or more than 1.5 times the baseline in 2 weeks. So when we came across this patient gave a history of 2 months. So two weeks to 3 months is the time where maximum damage to kidneys takes place in RPGN. And this is a renal emergency because every day more and more number of nephrons are lost. This causes irreversible kidney damage and the patient can progress to end-stage renal disease. So RPRF can be because of a vascular cause or a glomerular cause or a tubo-interstitial cause. So acute tubular interstitial nephritis, acute tubular necrosis and myeloma kidney are causes of tubulointerstitial disease. And among glomerular causes we have RPGN, and vascular causes could be thromboembolic disease or bilateral renal artery or a vein thrombosis. Then thrombotic micro angiopathy like HUS-TTP and APLA. So the challenge is to mainly differentiate between RPRF, CKD and AKI. So on history, if there is history of hematuria or frothing of urine, it could indicate that there is rapidly progressing renal failure if there's oliguria and anuria also. So if there are asthma, petechiae, hemoptysis, this could be suggestive of vasculitis. Or if there's photosensitivity or oral ulcer, this could be suggestive of SLE. If there's back pain, bony pain with fractures, it could be multiple myeloma. And if there's a significant drug history where the patient has taken nephrotoxic drugs, then that can also be considered. And long-standing hypertension and diabetes can also be the reasons. So there was pallor. So pallor can suggest CKD. Normal or high blood pressure can suggest thrombotic microangiopathy or renal artery stenosis. Rash over the skin or oral ulcers suggest SLE. Skin petechiae can suggest vasculitis and all this. Sometimes there will be involvement of the upper airway also that could suggest vaginas. So. Then we have to send routine investigations. So leukocytosis will be there in sepsis, in vasculitis or thromboembolic disease. Eosinophilia correlates with Churg-Strauss syndrome. So all these are there for various conditions. Urine analysis, if there are dysmorphic RBCs, it means that it's coming from the glomerular apparatus. If there are isomorphic RBCs, it could be things like a thromboembolic disease or acute interstitial nephritis. If there's nephrotic protein range, if there's nephrotic range proteinuria, then it could be because of other causes. Hypercalcemia, as in myeloma or sarcoidosis. Raised LDH in thrombotic microangiopathies and low complements like lupus nephritis, PSD and cryoglobulinemia. Raised ESR, CRP in vasculitis and HBsAg in can also cause membranoproliferative glomerulonephritis. Hepatitis C can also cause the same. And chest X-ray to look for any lung involvement if there are cavities. In serological tests, ANA, APLA, ANCA, anti-GBM antibodies, ASLO titers, cryoglobulins and anti-SCSMT, all these can be sent. So finally, we have to go for a renal biopsy to find out the histopathological variant of glomerulonephritis. So light microscopy can reveal crescents. It can show fibrin depositions and it can show necrotizing inflammation. Then immunofluorescence is done. So immunofluorescence will have a linear deposition in anti-GBM disease. If it is an immune complex mediated disease, there will be granular fluorescence. So that is basically scattered deposition throughout the glomerular basement membrane. And in posi immune RPGN, there will be hardly any immune complexes to go and deposit. So the staining of the glomerular tuft will not be very good. This is how it will look. The first one is anti-GBM disease where there's a linear deposition. Then in the second one, you can see that in some areas it is not well lit, some areas it is well lit. So that is called granular appearance. And in the third one, there's hardly any fluorescence. So there can be absence of dense immune complex deposits in type 1 and type 3 RPGN. In type 2, there will be lot of such deposits. So in the first picture, you can see how the basement membrane is broken down. And in the second picture, you can see that there are subepithelial and subendothelial deposits as it happens in immune complex mediated glomerulonephritis. So if there is concurrent lung hemorrhage along with kidney failure in an anti-GBM disease, it is called good pasture syndrome. If lung is not involved, only the kidneys are involved, it's called anti-GBM disease. Then along with granular immunofluorescence, if other inflammatory markers are also positive, then we can have various causes. We can have HSP, PSGN, membranoproliferative glomerulonephritis, SLE, etc. And if there's no immunofluorescence and ANCA is positive, then we call it ANCA glomerulonephritis. And there can be systemic associations with it, such as microscopic polyangiitis, Wegener's granulomatosis, and Churg-Strauss syndrome. So coming to RPGN type 1, this is what our patient had. Our patient did not have any involvement of the lung. So he had anti-GBM disease. So same, there was linear deposition as far as the immunofluorescence is concerned, and there were formation of crescents in light microscopy. Yeah, so this is the immunofluorescence. So when good pasture syndrome, when lung is involved, usually there is sparing of the costophrenic angle and the upper lobes. Usually the disease is perihilar and bibasilar. So these are the various organs which are involved in these small vessel vasculitis. Kidneys are most likely affected in microscopic polyangiitis. And lungs and upper respiratory tract is most likely affected in Wegener's granulomatosis, and skin and neurological manifestations are more in Churg-Strauss syndrome. So Wegener's granulomatosis most likely is a C ANCA associated vasculitis. 70% of cases show C ANCA positivity and only 25 show P ANCA positivity. In microscopic polyangiitis, 40% show C ANCA positivity and 50% show P ANCA positivity. In Churg-Strauss, only 10% are C ANCA positive and 60% are P ANCA positive. And in posi immune, 20% are C ANCA positive and 70% are P ANCA positive. So this is how C ANCA and P ANCA testing looks like. The first one, you can see that the cytoplasm of cell is green and the nucleus is dark. So basically it means that the antibodies have gone and attached to the cytoplasm proteins. So this is C ANCA because it's against the cytoplasm. And P ANCA has a perinuclear staining, so it doesn't show any particular shape when you look at the testing. So treatment is basically plasmapheresis is the treatment. Sir, two or three more, sir. Yes, sir. So treatment of choice is mainly plasmapheresis along with corticosteroid pulses. So most common drug which is used to pulse is methylprednisolone, and then people usually use cyclophosphamide as a long-term immunosuppression, but other agents like mycophenolate can also be used. Then patients should receive cotrimoxazole prophylaxis and should receive vaccinations against pneumococcal influenza and meningococcal disease. So there was an article which showed that patients who get a combined therapy of plasmapheresis along with corticosteroids show much better outcome as far as patient survival and renal survival is concerned. And those who get only corticosteroid therapy alone do not show a better renal outcome. And then patients should be assessed at the end of 2 to 3 week regimen. Yeah. So take home messages are basically that anti-GBM disease can cause RPGN, and it is actually the key to good prognosis is early diagnosis, and that a combination of plasmapheresis and corticosteroid therapy is the best thing for the patient. And if there is no if there's progression to end-stage renal disease and there's no improvement, then a renal replacement therapy should be considered.
Did this patient receive plasma exchange?
No, sir. He did not receive plasmapheresis. Because of some financial problems, they didn't opt for this.
Any other comments? Sahil, I think this is an excellent example of how not to present in a clinical meeting. Okay? Because you spent 2 slides on a clinical approach. You jumped straight into the investigations and your differentials are not even clinical. First differential was anemia and failure. You've not gone to even history of whether this patient had oliguria in your first slide of history. And the focus on the topic that you want to deal with has gone into so much about everything about anti-GBM, RPGN, diagnosis, management of ANCA. So try and be focused on what you're trying to convey. Because at the end of it, you've got PGs, interns, medical students, and consultants who want to take out a specific piece of information, and the challenge is how do you clinically approach it. Okay. The next